Hey, what's going on? It's your boy BT, and I came here to talk some boxing with the thousands of True School Sports subscribers. Now, good to be in front of the camera, good to talk some boxing with you guys today. Always a pleasure when we get here on True School Sports and get to, you know, talk about the sweet science. And I honestly was just catching up on some of the fights from this weekend. Obviously, I didn't get a chance to watch the top ranked card, Jamel Herring versus Masayuki Ito. You know, I didn't get a chance to watch this title fight, but I just got done watching it. I just want to get my take on what I saw from Jamel Herring. Now, for those of you who watched or didn't watch, you know, the result of the fight was, in fact, that Jamel Herring got a 12-round unanimous decision, and he is now the WBO world champion at 130. So, big win for him. But just as far as how the fight played out, you know, I thought it was a very interesting fight because when we talk about Masayuki Ito, you know, he's a fighter that he's a let's make no mistakes about it, and let's have no qualms, let's have no confusion. Masayuki Ito is a one-dimensional fighter. Solid fighter, beating some decent fighters. You know, he beat Christopher Diaz. He beat who was a good prospect on the way up. He also beat the guy's name. He beat another guy too, but he's a good fighter. You know, he's a solid, you know, world champion. So he's not a bum or like a weakling or anything like that. You know, good fighter. You know, has solid power in the right hand. But if you can take away the right hand, he becomes an absolutely ordinary fighter. So that was the fight plan from Jamel Herring. From the Jamel Herring side of things, you know, this was the biggest fight because for those of you who don't know, Jamel Herring last year in early 2018, he decided to hook up with Brian Bomack. You know, McIntyre, the trainer for one Terrence Crawford. And he's been training at Omaha, Nebraska with the Crawford camp. This is his fourth fight under Brian McIntyre. This was their, like, first big moment. So, you know, just it was a good test for them against Ito. Now, Jamel Herring, for those of you who don't know, you know, in his career, he's taken some tough losses. One loss of his that sticks out in my mind was a couple years ago when he fought Denis Shafikov. And Denis Shafikov absolutely beat the brakes off of Jamel Herring. I remember just with that fight where they lost, and pretty much all the fights he lost in the past, that Jamel Herring had always had a problem with his stamina. You know, if you can get Jamel Herring into the later rounds and put a pressure on him, you could beat Jamel Herring. And, you know, that was the concern going into this fight with Ito. But in the fight, you know, first of all, first half of the fight, first six rounds, Jamel Herring was absolutely brilliant. You know, and it's funny because he's been working with Terrence Crawford and listening to Terrence Crawford, and I could kind of see some Terrence Bud Crawford just, you know, sneak his way into his skill set and his fighting style. You know, he'd be here with the jab, so he'd lean off to the side. He'd have you in a southpaw stance. You know, he's double jabbing, slipping. You know, and you see him just moving a lot more relaxed and loose. And so, and the thing is, for the weight class, he's got a good range for the weight class. So, you know, range control, distance, it's very important for Jamel Herring at 130. And he showed it in this fight. He was sticking the jab. He was moving. You know, if Ito got lazy, because there were times when Ito got lazy, dropped his hands for a second, you know, he stayed sharp. You know, the punches weren't necessarily these long punches, but, you know, he stayed sharp. It would look something like this. He'd be like, you know, moving and grooving. And sometimes, you know, the left hand would catch Ito. And, you know, one thing he did early on in the fight was he got Masayuki Ito's attention very early. And that, it made his life a lot easier in the first half of that fight because he was able to establish that jab. He was able to get, you know, the lead foot positioning, which is very important when you fight a fighter like Ito who is looking up, who's looking to cock that right hand and load it up and hurt you. And so because he was able to use his range, control the distance, and get his foot on the inside and the outside if he wanted to, you know, position of Masayuki Ito, he was able to control how the fight was fought for the first half of the fight. Only thing I would say about the first half of the fight for Jamel Herring was Ito kept moving, like, because Ito's an orthodox fighter, Jamel Herring's a southpaw. So every time Ito would go to his right, he was lining himself up right for the straight left hand. And I feel like he could have thrown that punch a little bit more earlier in the first six rounds. He did it for whatever reason, so that's his prerogative. But, you know, fair play to him. You know, I thought he won the first six rounds easy. Heading into the second, you know, half of the fight, the last six rounds, Jamel Herring was tested a lot more because he had to stay switched on mentally. And, you know, Masayuki Ito, it was around the latter parts of the sixth round itself where Masayuki Ito landed the right hand. And in the seventh round, he landed a two or three punch combination. And it, you know, it landed flush on Jamel Herring. So Ito was beginning to find him, figure himself out. And he asked some questions of Jamel Herring. And I think, you know, prior to him working with Brian McIntyre and Terrence Crawford, I think this would have been the stage of the fight where you see Jamel Herring break down, fold up, get folded up like a chair. But that's not what we saw here in this fight. We saw him, okay, did he get hit a little bit? Was he asking tough questions, you know, from Masayuki Ito? Yes, he was. But he was able to stay composed, get back on his jab. You know, there were some times in the middle parts of the second half of the fight where he was fighting Masayuki Ito on the inside, and he was going to the body, and he was digging. And he had some success with that. But the fight ultimately ended with him winning the majority of the rounds, you know, putting on a really good performance. You know, I would say, if you go watch the fight on the commentary, it's Andre Ward. You know, big shout out to Andre Ward as a commentator, fantastic commentator. Andre Ward was talking about when the fight started. He said, Jamel Herring has to go from he has to, on this night tonight, he's got to eliminate that B side mentality and start fighting like have that A side mentality. You know, and what he meant when he said that is, you know, a lot of times when you're the B side guy or you're the guy that's brought in to lose in the opposite corner, you know, you can go into a fight not be expected to win, get a good count of yourself. Maybe you have a case that you won the fight. And that's what it is. But the A-side guy is going to be looked to not just win, but win in impressive fashion. And I thought it was I don't want to say it was an overwhelmingly impressive performance from Jamel Herring, but I was impressed. I was impressed with the growth I saw from Jamel Herring, because this was not the guy that fought Dennis Shafikov all those years ago and got his ass whooped on ESPN and whatnot. You know, this was a much different fighter. So that's just what it was. Now, one thing I found interesting was, you know, Terrence Crawford is in, obviously, helping Jamel Herring. And Terrence Crawford was yelling instructions ringside for him. And you know, Terrence Crawford has become kind of like an unofficial coach for Jamel Herring. And, you know, and listening to Terrence Crawford speak and listening to some of and seeing some of the things that Jamel Herring has kind of picked up in the ring, you know, it goes to show you the boxing IQ Terrence Crawford has. And the fact of how respected he is that, you know, fighters who are currently fighting at world championship level are looking to him for guidance, you know. It was interesting. I think it was the ninth round or after the eighth round. One of those rounds, Jamel Herring was going back to his corner. And before he sat down, he looked over at Terrence Crawford ringside, you know, because I think Terrence was yelling something at him about, you know, what he should be doing in the ring. And then Brian McIntyre was like, man, when you're in this corner, you pay attention to us. So that was pretty funny. But overall, it was a good performance. You know, now we're looking at Jamel Herring being the WBO 130-pound champion, and it sets up some big fights for him. You know, most notably, a fighter that was there ringside was Miguel Berchelt. You know, Berchelt was there ringside, and Berchelt's coming off that sixth round TKO win over Francisco Vargas in their rematch, and you know, he's probably one of the most exciting offensive fighters to watch in all of boxing. So that'd be a good fight because Herring has become a more defensively sound fighter. You know, in this fight with Ito, you saw Herring, you know, taking the subtle things he was doing, man. It was almost like I was watching, like, and this is no disrespect to Jamel Herring, but some things he was doing, he was kind of like the bootleg Terrence Crawford. But I mean that with the utmost respect, because Terrence is a great fighter. So, because, you know, Ito would be loading up for the right hand, right? And sometimes when he would load up for the right hand, he would take these big steps forward. And every time he took a irregular step forward, Herring would take a half step back, and he would make Masayuki Ito have to reset. And these are the subtle things that, you know, to the untrained eye, you won't notice in boxing. But I saw these things, and you know, Herring has improved a lot under Brian McIntyre, and I believe that if he continues to, you know, listen to Brian McIntyre, pick up some things with Terrence Crawford, he'll do well for himself, because you know, he's always been a solid fighter. He's always had a solid foundation, but the one thing for him has always been, you know, his stamina. And in this fight, his stamina was not an issue. He trained up there in Colorado Springs. But yeah, Miguel Berchelt could be a potential unification fight for him moving forward, because they're both top rank affiliated. You know, Berchelt is a really good fighter. You know, a fun offensive fighter. Jamel Herring is an improving fighter. You know, a good defensive fighter with good range to boot. You know, I think it'd be a really good fight. I like to see those two get it on. Those guys are both respectable fighters, and they deserve praise. And that's a fight that I think Top Rank and all parties involved should look into. As for Jamel Herring, you know, he's a absolutely exceptional person, you know, from what I've never met him, but from what I can see, because, you know, after the fight, he went ahead and he actually gave the world title back to Masayuki Ito. And I thought that was so humble of him, because it's like, in his finest hour as a boxer, you know he's been through so much in his life and in his career, you know, serving two tours for the Marine Corps, you know, served our great country of America in Iraq, you know, then he then went ahead and you know, started a pro boxing career, took some tough losses. You know, the one that stuck out to me was Denis Shabakov. You know, got stopped and beaten pretty soundly in that fight, and then had lost, you know, probably had underachieved a bit as a fighter, hooks up with Ryan McIntyre, and then he becomes world champion. In his finest hour, he's showing respect to his opponent in a way that I don't see many fighters show respect to their opponents. So, you know, I like the class that was shown from Jamel Herring. I like the fact that he listens to his corner. I like the fact that he has humility. I like the fact that he's an improving fighter, and I want to see him do well in boxing because, you know, he's someone that's very likable. So I got another respect for Jamel Herring. You know, this was a really good fight. I liked the focus, the footwork, the ability to use his range, to use that height and reach that he does have, the counter punching. You know, it was a solid, it was a really good fight for him. And Berchelt, I think, would be an even bigger test of his composure, because Berchelt is a more complete offensive fighter than Masayuki Ito. Ito's just looking he's looking to land the right hand, but he don't necessarily set the jab up behind it and then throw the right hand. But with Berchelt, you know, you get the jab, you get the right hand, you get hooks, you get uppercuts, you get a lot of infighting, and you gotta understand what Berchelt, he's had two fights, roughly 18 rounds, of just top level infighting with Francisco Vargas. So he's not your regular, you know, inside fighter. He's one of the better infighters in boxing today. So it'd be a good test. I think that's a fight they should look into. But that's just my take on Jamel Herring versus Masayuki Ito. Just some of my takeaways and things I'm seeing. But yeah, you guys let me know what you think in the comments down below about Jamel Herring's performance. You know, let me know what you guys think in the comments down below about what he should do next, what you thought about this performance, all that good stuff. And like I say in every single one of my videos, you can love me or you can hate me. But I'm Jessica from Daniel. So until next time, take care, guys.